This week marks 30 years since India embraced economic reforms to unshackle itself from the license permit quota raj. It so significantly altered the economic course of our nation that on its 25th anniversary, the Hindu carried this headline: Manmohan Singh's 1991 budget, the day that changed India forever. This week, as we mark its 30th anniversary, we cannot but retrospect on how our country has changed over the last 30 years. Terrific in some ways, terrible in some other ways. Three terrific things first. One, poverty busting. The best thing we've done over the past 30 years is to pull 300 million people out of poverty. Repeat, 300 million people. Over the past 30 years, India's poverty ratio has come down from 46.3% of the population to 21.9% of the population. And at that same period, per capita incomes per month have grown from 583 rupees per month per person to 12,140 rupees per month per person, or a growth of 20.8x. And to think all of this required only a change of track from our deep-rooted socialist policies. And the change was accomplished virtually overnight by a core team comprising P.V. Narasimha Rao, Manmohan Singh, Montek Singh Ahluwalia, C. Rangarajan, and a few others. Like Ahluwalia recalled this week, it took only 8 hours to change our trade policy and fast-track India. Number two, a biocentric thinking. Now, this is something not many would have noticed, and to be sure, we haven't made much progress here. But this is one aspect that suggests that India can really rejuvenate its age-old and earthy wisdom. Biocentrism is the philosophy that puts nature at the core of our existence, in contrast to anthropocentrism, which argues that humans are the most significant of all species and that all resources can be exploited for humans. Can you believe that the Supreme Court has stepped in for the cause of the great Indian bustard? These endangered birds have poor frontal vision and tend to collide with overhead power lines. The court has asked the Rajasthan and Gujarat governments to install bird diverters so that these birds don't collide with power lines. Now, this is high thinking, a biocentric reasoning, and an expression of civilizational intelligence. Go back to the 1991 budget speech of Manmohan Singh, who said, "We cannot deforest our way to prosperity, and we cannot pollute our way to prosperity." We have polluted enough over the past 30 years. Today, 13 of the 15 most polluted cities in the world are in India. And over the past 30 years, we have lost roughly 29,000 square kilometers of forests. But the bright spot, we are now taking the 1991 budget speech seriously and thinking of biocentrism. Number three, unicorn spawning. When the reform doors were opened in 1991, most Indian entrepreneurs had manufacturing ideas in mind, from refrigerators and television sets to cosmetics and shaving razors. But in recent years, virtually in the blink of an eye, everyone from Mukesh Ambani to college startups have caught on to the digital domain. And all of a sudden, India has turned a global unicorn hotspot. You've heard of Baiju's, Oyo Rooms, Ola, and the absolutely mind-boggling 1 trillion rupee valuation of Zomato. But there are even more stunning statistics of Indian unicorns. In the first 6 months of 2021 alone, mind you, this is a COVID year, 16 more have joined the unicorn club in India, including BrowserStack, Zeta, Moglix, an urban company. At this rate, India will have 100 unicorns by 2023, much before the 2025 milestone that we had set. And now the terrible three. Number one, a devalued education. What has been devalued over the past 30 years more than the Indian rupee? One contender, Indian education. Little has changed with India's rote learning education system over the past 30 years, except perhaps of a PPT coming into Indian classrooms. So Indian media today is awash with advertisements saying study in the UK, study in US, study in Germany, study in Australia, study in Kazakhstan. What these ads stop at saying is, for heaven's sake, don't study in India. So whoever can escape Indian education does it. Remember, India's first COVID patient was a student from Thrissur, Kerala, who was studying in Wuhan, China. And with this broken education system, we nurse unreasonable and sky-high expectations. Like having one single hour for physical training per week in our schools, we expect Olympic champions to come out of the system. Number two, the corruption curse. In 1991, corruption was very much part of our system. But over the next 30 years, it has multiplied like cancer cells do. What an irony that Manmohan Singh, the finance minister who ushered in reforms in 1991, had to preside over the largest wave of corruption in independent India when he was prime minister. Now that the Congress is out of power, other parties seem to have taken over the reins of corruption. This week, a charge sheet submitted in a Thrissur court says the BJP had illegally sourced 400 million rupees from Karnataka and allegedly distributed it among party office bearers in Kerala just before the state assembly election. Also this week, several CPM leaders in Kerala are accused of a 3 billion rupee cooperative bank loan scam. Like politicians, like bureaucrats. This week, the CBI is investigating a gun license scam in Jammu and Kashmir, where some civil servants are suspected to have connived with gun dealers to issue illegal gun licenses to ineligible people. Gun licenses? Oh yes, the license raj in India hasn't gone anywhere. So from Kashmir to Kerala, we continue to have scams. Number three, a ragged social fabric. Besides the wars India has engaged in, if one were to put a finger on two defining incidents of post-independent India, they would be July 24, 1991, the liberalizing budget, and December 6, 1992, the demolition of Babri Masjid. The wounds of the latter continue to fester. Nearly 30 years after the demolition, the monster of hatred and distrust continue to haunt us. So much so that in many social groups, discussing politics is banned. Imagine in a democracy, social groups deciding not to discuss politics because we've lost the gift of reason and now believe only in ranting and raving. So, sadly, for all the prosperity we've unleashed over the last 30 years, we yearn for the good old days of 1991 when we lived with such warmth, brotherhood, and camaraderie. This video is dedicated to a lady with powerful arms from Imphal, Manipur, and a young man without both arms from Alathur, Kerala. Mirabai Chanu, who flexed her arms this week to win a weightlifting medal for India at the Tokyo Olympics, and Pranav M. Balasubramanian, a 22-year-old born without both arms, who received his first COVID vaccination jab on his leg. Mirabai showed early promise when at 12 years she could lift more firewood than her elder brother. Of course, Olympic medals don't come easy. She reportedly went home only 5 times over the last 5 years and almost totally gave up on her favorite pizzas and burgers. Pranav cycled to the vaccination center for his jab. How does he do it? By pressing his chest against the handlebar for balance. The BCom graduate is also a good painter. Last year, he had donated 5,000 rupees to the Chief Minister's Disaster Relief Fund, raising the funds by selling his paintings. Mirabai and Pranav belong to India's post-reforms generation. Both terrific, demonstrating how one can succeed with arms or without arms. Thank you.